Welcome to the Real Estate Guys radio program. I'm your host, Robert Helms. As we wrap up the first month of the new year, it's time to look ahead with our 2021 predictions panel. You're going to hear from lots of smart folks to find out what they're looking towards in 2021. Today on the Real Estate Guys radio program.
If you love real estate and have always wanted to own your own business, listen up. The Real Estate Guys and their panel of experts want to teach you how to go full-time fast in the real estate syndication business. These next few years may go down in history as one of the best times ever to acquire investment real estate. There are deals everywhere if you know where to look and how to assemble the resources. The Secrets of Successful Syndication Seminar will show you how to make big money doing big deals from a team of experts that have syndicated projects totaling more than $1 billion. Don't wait for someone to give you a raise or create a job for you. Attend the Secrets of Successful Syndication and learn how to build a team, raise capital, find deals, and make full-time money in 6 months or less. Go to realestateguysradio.com and click on events. All the big players use syndication as a way to diversify risk, optimize profits, and earn big money. You can too. Go to realestateguysradio.com and click on events.
Welcome to the Real Estate Guys radio program. Thanks for tuning into the show. It is pretty quick out of the gate with the new year. We're still in January, and we're going to do something that we do every year around this time, and that is it's our annual predictions panel. First, let's say hello to our co-host and financial strategist, Russell Gray.
Hey, Robert.
You know, Russ, this is a great chance for you and I to pick the brains of some pretty smart folks and find out what they're looking towards in 2021.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think my favorite thing about being the co-host of the show is all the big brain people we get a chance to meet and talk to who will take our calls. And every time we ask them questions, we always throw on the microphones. But if you think about your real estate, investing, obviously there's a macro picture. We care about interest rates. We care about the value of the currency. We care about policies that affect jobs. There's a whole lot of policy change going on right now, especially in the energy sector, which has been a big job creator. Obviously, COVID-19 and the fallout of that has people moving and businesses moving and things happening that are kind of part of the new normal. So there's a lot of things to sort out since we did our COVID-19 crisis investing series at the beginning of 2020. And really interested to hear what these big brain folks have to say about what they foresee in 2021.
We have a variety of guests today from different walks of economic life, and it's going to be rapid fire, but you're going to dig it. We come back, our 2021 predictions panel on the Real Estate Guys radio program.
Hi, I'm Mark Victor Hans. You're listening to the Real Estate Guys. If you want to expand your consciousness, expand your wealth, expand your future, and have more delight and excite in your future than in your past, keep listening to the Real Estate Guy.
Well, welcome everybody. I'm Robert Helms, the Real Estate Guys radio program. It is practically a brand new year upon us. And one of the things we do in the first month of the new year is ask the smartest people we know, what are they paying attention to? What are they looking at? What are they looking for down the road? Because change happens gradually, and sometimes change happens all at once. Let's say hello to someone who keeps their eyes on the economy, the financial markets, and even real estate. From Quill Intelligence, it's our friend Danielle DiMartino-Booth. Hey, Danielle.
How are you? Happy New Year.
Well, Happy New Year to you. Always great to see your smiling face. And you pay attention to a lot that's going on, and there is a lot that's going on. I guess the big picture is we can put the presidential election in the United States behind us, and we can see where some things are going, but it's still not crystal clear. What are you looking at right now?
Well, I think that the market, I think on inauguration day, the market was like, woohoo, we're going from 600 to 2000 per person. And we're doing it, you know, initially, I think Chuck Schumer had said money in the hands before the end of January.
Right.
And boy, it sounded really good at the time. I mean, it really did. And when you consider that so many of the recipients either added money to savings or put money into the stock market, it was a pretty exciting prospect. And yet here we are now talking about hopefully by the middle of March, dot, 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 in parentheses, that is when those extra unemployment benefits run out. So it had better be by the middle of March. So we're back to a waiting game. It seems like the more things change, you know, the more they stay the same.
Yeah, isn't it true? Now, let's talk about real estate a bit. I know you keep your eye out on this. In fact, you've been monitoring some recent moves, transaction, things that are happening in marketplaces. What are you looking at in real estate that might give some insight to our listeners?
So real estate is as bifurcated as it's ever been. It's not about location, location, location. It's about whether you're in the urban center or in the exurb. And there's really not much in between right now. So, you know, 2020 was an interesting year. You have seen, and you continue to see, rents falling in these big metro areas. Fresh data out of TREP shows that in the month of December, we saw multifamily delinquencies pop from like 4.9% up to 16 and change. percent. So we're definitely seeing the lagged effects of multifamily urban centers start to show real stress. And yet you see an announcement from InvestCorp that they're plunking several hundred million dollars into apartments in the suburbs of Atlanta, the suburbs of Jacksonville, Florida. They're effectively following the people out of the cities, and you're going to end up having a greater demand for type B properties, let's say, in some of these suburban markets where you have indeed seen rental price appreciation very steadfast, not under any pressure vis-a-vis those big city centers. So it's going to be a matter of, you know, where office and multifamily is weak and where it is not.
You know, Danielle, you were part of our crisis webinar series that we recorded kind of midway through 2020. And one of the things you were pointing to were these big moves in real estate. The fact that people were leaving New York City, people were leaving higher income markets. And then now we see that the eviction moratoriums have been extended, pretty tough for landlords and lenders. And that's going to have something to do with performance and maybe even availability of properties. But the other thing is you have people that are making life decisions now based on their changing roles. A lot of people that used to have to get up and go to an office, for example, are not doing that because they can do their work from home. How do you see that impacting specifically real estate going forward?
So, you know, a word that is being thrown around by macroeconomists right now is scarring. And I think that we're going, the same way we're going to see scarring in the labor force, I think, and more permanent unemployment than any of us are expecting in the aftermath of a pandemic. It's not going to be that reopening is not going to bring everybody back into the workforce. That's a fallacy, but we're also going to see scarring in the real estate sector. And I think what's important to appreciate is where the construction and development had been in the prior decade leading up to this. People don't appreciate that one in 10 employees worldwide was working in travel and tourism. 50% of hotel-backed, commercial mortgage-backed securities, this is one of my favorite statistics, are backed by luxury hotels. So there's a lot of stress that is yet to be realized. And in large part, it is because of the changing roles. You may be a consultant with Bain or McKinsey or Deloitte, and you might have been a road warrior in your past life. 12 months later, you know, they're discovering that they're able to get the same amount per hour from the client, but have a lot more go straight to the bottom line because they're not flying their employee out on a business class airfare. They're not parking him or her at the Four Seasons or the Ritz-Carlton for four nights a week. They're saving a lot of money, but the ripple effects through to especially higher end office properties, higher end multifamily, and boy, higher end hotels, this is going to take a generation to work itself out. This is not going to be something that heals itself quickly. Because once corporations realize fatter profit margins, it's going to be difficult to get them to change their ways just so that road warriors can go back to having road warrior lifestyles.
Excellent points. Hey, let's talk about the fuel that real estate investors use. Of course, leverage and the ability to borrow money to buy apartment buildings and commercial buildings and even single family homes. What are you seeing there? Maybe interest rates and how big lenders are responding.
So, you know, I think that there's something of a tug of war right now because we know that interest rates, we know that the 30-year fixed mortgage, for example, on the residential side is at a record low level. And yet you're starting to see home builder optimism roll over. And I don't know that we were expecting to see that at this juncture. And then you look at home prices and then you look at lumber prices. And you have to realize that there's, you know, there's more to the profit math than there is simply the ability via lower or record low mortgage rates to get into a property. And you also haven't seen with small and mid-sized banks the end of the story of commercial real estate loan write-offs. So there's going to be a reticence on the part of certain banks. Small and mid-sized banks are much more exposed than they were heading into 2020 than they were in 2007, 2008. The flip side of that is the largest banks have half the exposure commercial real estate loan exposure that they had going into the crisis. They're much better positioned to finance well thought out, a lot of distressed property, a lot of distressed deals going forward, because they're not sitting on these loan losses that have yet to be realized on the real estate side.
Well, we love the fact that you pay attention to all kinds of things, but you have real estate thrown in there. So we could go on forever and pick your big brain. But for the nature of today's show, just wanted to check in and get your feelings about real estate, what you're watching. And as always, you don't let us down. Thank you so much, Danielle.
Thank you. Take care.
There's Danielle DiMartino-Booth. She's the author of Fed Up, Why the Federal Reserve is Bad for America. And she spent 9 years there. She ought to know. If you haven't picked up that amazing book, here's your invitation to do that. You're tuned to the Real Estate Guys radio program. More when we come back, I'm your host, Robert Helms.
Real estate investment advice right in your mailbox. Sign up for the free Real Estate Guys newsletter at realestateguysradio.com.
Hear ye, hear ye. Registration is now open for the Real Estate Guys 19th Annual Investor Summit. Imagine spending an entire week with like-minded investors, world-class educators, and real-world professionals. Returning this year, our sales legend Tom Hopkins, the editor of the Gold Newsletter Brian London, international real estate developer Beth Clifford, and Jim Rohn's 18-year business partner Kyle Wilson. And joining us live and in person for his 9th Investor Summit, Peter Schiff. Plus, returning for his 9th Investor Summit, best-selling author and the Rich Dad Advisor for Real Estate, Ken McElroy. Plus, lots more to be announced. It all begins June 11th in beautiful Belize. Visit realestateguysradio.com and click the tab that says Summit to reserve your spot. This transformational week is like no conference you've ever attended. Go to realestateguysradio.com and click Summit and make plans to spend a week with the Real Estate Guys, Peter Schiff, Ken McElroy, and an all-star faculty on the 19th Annual Investor Summit. For thousands of years of human history, silver has been recognized as money. Then in 1965, the United States took silver out of the financial system. But did silver stop being money? Smart investors don't think so. And ever since, when there are concerns about the quality of the currency, alert investors seek shelter in silver and gold. As the size and frequency of major financial crises grow, silver is attracting a lot of attention. To help better understand the what, why, and how of silver, watch the free 9-part series, Making Sense of Silver. Everything you always wanted to know about silver but didn't know to ask. Featuring 30-year precious metals veteran Dana Samuelson. Send your email requests to silverseries@realestateguysradio.com. Whether you own silver now or you're wondering if it's too late, email silverseries@realestateguysradio.com.
Hi, this is Chris Martinson, author of Prosper, and you are listening to The Real Estate Guys.
Welcome back to The Real Estate Guys radio program. Thanks so much for tuning into the show. Tell a friend about The Real Estate Guys. It is our brand new year, and we're talking about predictions. And hearing from a lot of folks who have earned the right to have an opinion about where things are going. Let's welcome back to The Real Estate Guys radio program from John Burns Consulting, Mr. John Burns. Hey, John, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, Robert.
I know you guys spend a ton of time looking out on the horizon, finding out what's going on in marketplaces and product types and design. For mostly builders and developers, what are some of the things you see or are watching in 2021?
Well, I'll just start with, I'm assuming the presidential transition year isn't going to make a big difference in the market. We're going to get all new leaders overseas. FHA, Fannie, and Freddie, but the bond market is still predicting that the 10-year will be flat, and so the 30-year mortgage should be flat too. So that being said, in the economy recovering, we're very bullish on price appreciation. The demand for housing as far outstripping the supply, not in the way that we need a hell of a lot more shelter, but there's so many more people out buying than there are people selling. And actually, we've been surveying investors, and we do one, and I'd love your listeners to email Devin Bachman, who's on the show with me here, and to get part of the survey. I think a lot of the demand is being driven by investors, in fact, an inordinate amount. That makes me very bullish on price appreciation, but if we have several years of demand being driven by investors, we all know how that ends. So I'm going to say we're very bullish here, but we're also putting up our our guard to watch the risks and pay careful attention to affordability.
Fair enough. Well, let's bring in Devin on this. Devin Bachman, you pay attention to the markets and, of course, do the surveys. Tell us what you're seeing in terms of what we might expect in 2021.
So I was going to mention price appreciation, but John brought that to our attention. So I would also say when you're looking from a demand perspective, we're going to see growth. But we set records this year on the demand front. So you have to grow off of what is already a very difficultly high number. So we're going to see growth, but it's not going to be the double digits that we're seeing this year. It will be a little bit more modest with really solid pricing power combined with that.
You know, a few weeks back, we had you guys on the show talking about the build for rent space, which is certainly a place we're all watching. Are there any other niches or markets or things that you are paying attention to?
I mean, one thing that has not been growing is land supply. In fact, starting the year, the builders have fewer actively selling new home communities than they did a year ago. Once we got the all clear in the fourth quarter that sales were strong, they've been out buying land like crazy. So I'll point out, there'll probably be headlines about the significant growth in construction this year, but it really is very small in comparison to the homes that have already been sold. They're just playing catch up. So I feel very confident supply is going to stay pretty low for quite some time. Obviously, as an investor, you need to watch supply in your local market. So that's what we're paying a lot of attention to.
Devin, something to add there?
Yeah, I would say it's supply issues on all fronts. So it's supply, land supply, it's finished home supply, it's even supply challenges as it goes into the products that go into the homes themselves. There's been lots of manufacturing and distribution issues with the pandemic. So it's not just like the supply problem is centered in one category. You really have this broad supply challenge across those three different categories. Lots of demand, really low supply, perfect recipe for price appreciation.
Now, when you have this demand and when we're seeing it, right, and continue to see it and expecting it to increase, obviously, you know, developers, builders are looking for what to build, where to build, but they're also employing, right? And they've got tradespeople and they've got subcontractors. How's that looking? Any concerns there for supply chain, logistics? Do you see any of that?
The labor shortage has been around for a while, and a lot of people are retiring. I just read that the construction employment is down year over year, which stuns me, but it's because commercial construction is down.
Sure.
I think what the industry needs to do is recruit a bunch of commercial construction guys over to residential because they need more labor there. You know, as we were just talking about supply, I probably forgot the most important thing that nobody's been talking about, which is foreclosure supply, which created a great opportunity for everybody. The FHA delinquency rate is higher than it was during the great financial crisis. But what's different is that they haven't started the foreclosure process on anybody. They've got rules in place to try to modify a loan. That's going to be something to pay a heck of a lot of attention to, is how does essentially this time the federal government handle all these people that haven't been paying their mortgage. Their plan is that if you've got a job again, let's restructure your loan. And if you miss 12 months of payments, we'll just make it a 31-year mortgage and tack it onto the back end and all will be fine. Not everybody is going to make it through that cycle. So I know a lot of your listeners are hoping there's a whole bunch of foreclosures coming and I can invest in those. Or maybe they're hoping there's none coming so they can keep raising the rent. But we're monitoring that closely. The last thing I'll say on that I think is important, though, and I hate to be the this time is different guy, but what will be different this time if that happens is you have all this institutional capital that's already in the business of single family rental. I think they'll be there to scoop up those homes as soon as they come. I think there's something in place now that can keep home prices from falling very significantly. And it's that capital.
Well, as we look out across the horizon at all the different product types within real estate, certainly residential's got to be the strong place. I mean, people need a roof over their heads, and there may be restaurants and bars and bowling alleys and gyms out of business, but all right, people are spending more time, not less time at home. So I know that's the area you guys focus on, single family. And again, this is the beginning of the year, so none of us know what's going to happen. But I know you guys spend a lot of time just looking forward. Any other thoughts, Devin, on where the puck may be going in the new year?
Well, I would just say to your point there that our home has now become our security gate. our front door has become our frontline defense to the virus. And so people have placed so much value on a home, and that can be a home to rent, and that can be a home to own, but it is a space to call their own. It is their slice of blue sky, their little patch of green. And I don't think that's going away anytime soon. We have done research on how quickly it takes a human to form a habit, and it's somewhere between that 60 and 90 day mark. Well, we're way further into the COVID pandemic than that. So I think that drive for that slice of home ownership or rentership or a space I call my own is not going anywhere anytime soon.
All right. Love that. Well, John and Devin and their team do a lot of work in this area. And if you're interested in learning more, you can go to realestateconsulting.com. Thanks, guys, for sharing, and Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, Robert.
Thank you.
Every year, near the beginning of the year, we ask our experts to kind of paint the future for us. It's our predictions panel, and it's a pleasure to welcome back to the program from Peak Financing, Anton Mattli. Anton, how are you?
Hi, Robert. Great. What about yourself?
All is well. Just looking forward to hopefully a very different 2021. Still a lot of craziness going on, but you're in the multifamily financing space, Anton, and this has obviously been a hot area. Multifamily's been hot. The financing around multifamily is among the cheapest and best financing there is. So paint us a picture. What are you watching for this year?
Yes. So as you said, multifamily has been doing extremely well through COVID-19. There are some other commercial real estate spots that have done really well. Obviously, the darling right now, even more so than the multifamily, has been industrial, right? Particularly the logistics space, data center, and so on. But multifamily definitely has done really well. And part of that is also because financing is still readily available through the agencies like Fannie and Freddie and HUD. So that certainly has helped a lot. And we do not really see that there is much of a difference in 2021. But we still see some distress with some properties where they have a harder time with collections. As we have heard from the Biden administration, that are extending the eviction moratorium to the end of March, potentially all the way down out to September of 2021. We do not know that yet, but that definitely will create some problems for the less hands-on operators and property management companies. So I see, particularly in the first half, that there are some buying opportunities for multifamily. But I do not really see a significant price reduction, right? So it's more kind of on a case-by-case basis, like for properties that already suffered in pre-COVID periods, the ones that went into a forbearance arrangement with the lenders and now they have to come back and pay up for it, right? Because now they had the benefit of forbearance, but now they need to come back and pay it all back. So there are certainly some opportunities there. When it comes to the financing environment, and that obviously has an impact also on valuations, what we see is that the short-term rates that the government can control and all the governments around the world can control will stay low. They will stay at record lows, I believe, not just this year, but probably even further out. With all that money printing that we have been seeing now, that obviously has been pushed even further with COVID-19, there is such a massive amount of money that is put into the market in the US and around the world. So what we believe is that while the short-term rates that can be better controlled by the government, that we certainly see inflationary pressure. And with that also the all-important 10-year treasury yield for commercial real estate, including multifamily, that we definitely see a steepening of the yield curve that also then impacts the 10-year treasury yield. Where I see it to likely, I would not be surprised if we see a 2% in front of that number. We are now roughly at one, as we speak, at 1.1, right? Just as a very rough number. We have seen a jump up beam above the 115. It has retracted since then a little bit, but it wouldn't surprise me if we are at the 2% mark plus. but I definitely see it to be at 150 and above by the year end. So certainly when it comes to refinancing, I would say this is now a very good time as long as the property is still in good shape and cash flows well. Cap rates are still at record lows. So it's a very good opportunity to refinance. And if you buy a property, even though you're maybe a little bit uncertain where what the future holds, at least you still can lock in long-term financing that is really attractive. For those that want to stay more flexible with the floating rate programs, you have another option to stay with very low borrowing costs for a longer time and protect it still with interest rate caps. Right? So there also leaves a lot of options there.
Excellent. Well, those are some things to watch for sure. And of course, everything's case by case. So when you sit down with somebody and look at their situation, the property, its history, what the rent roll looks like, you can certainly counsel folks. And the other part is how long they expect to have it. And is this a buy and hold forever property? Or is it something that they're planning to reposition after a few years and those kinds of things? You know, when we last had you on the show, we had talked about how the lenders had to change course a little bit when COVID happened, and there were the requirements for additional reserves and so forth. Now with the eviction moratorium on a federal level being pushed out, how do you see lenders responding to that, to their existing book of business?
I think as a result of this, these P&I principal and interest reserves will stay in place for quite some time. I do not really see, even with vaccinations being rolled out very aggressively, and a larger percentage of the population being vaccinated by hopefully May and June, I do not really see that the lenders will retract from their COVID-19 principal and escrow requirements. Maybe in the second half, but it depends a lot on where these eviction moratoriums are at this point. And also just where the economy is in its recovery phase, right? We have obviously the mutations of some of the COVID-19 strains. So that is another risk that is there. So the agencies are watching it very closely. But I do not see that it will move away from the in-place requirements. Hopefully they will ease it later in 2021, but I do not see any changes in the first half.
You know, it's interesting to watch how the showing of apartments and the management of apartments and everything outside financing has also evolved during the pandemic. And so I would imagine that some of those practices will continue. People that are doing virtual showings or unattended showings, people that are doing their walkthroughs differently and the like. So everything has been affected. And as we're looking forward, we're also looking back, you know, you can tell by the way that folks in the space went through their initial response that gave you a clue. And so we're seeing some of those things. So appreciate your input on that. And Anton has a great report he put together. If you didn't get a chance to pick this up when we had him on the program in December, it's called The Ultimate Guide to Financing Your Apartment Complex. You get a copy by sending an email to multifamily@realestateguysradio.com. Anton, always great to hear from you. Thanks for being on the predictions panel.
Yeah, same here. Thanks, Robert.
It's our annual predictions panel. We're talking with folks who have earned the right to have an opinion about where the puck may be headed. More panelists on the way, and we'll play real estate trivia next. You're tuned to the Real Estate Guys radio program. I'm your host, Robert Helms.
Live nationwide, you're listening to the Real Estate Guys. Find out more at realestateguysradio.com.
Hey, it's Robert Helms. Thanks so much for listening to the show today. I want to personally invite you to come see an amazing real estate market that combines excellent cash flow, offshore diversification, and what we affectionately call lifestyle investing. Come join me from April 16th to 19th in the beautiful country of Belize. The Real Estate Guys have been bringing investors to Belize for more than 15 years now. And with the Belize airport open again, our discovery trip is designed to show you the market like nobody else can. Sure, Belize is breathtakingly beautiful, the people are wonderful, and wait till you taste the food. But the real opportunity is the real estate investment potential. Demand for offshore real estate has skyrocketed since the coronavirus shutdown, and with retirees looking for lifestyle, the work-from-home workforce able to be productive from afar, and tourism coming back strong, now may be the perfect time to consider Belize as a place to diversify risk in your investment portfolio. There's all types of opportunity in Belize when it comes to real estate investing, including both long and short-term rentals, commercial and retail triple net properties, business opportunities, land acquisition, development, agriculture, and more. And as the only country in Latin America with English as its official language, it's easy to understand the law. Property rights are strong, and contracts are in English. And in Ambergris Key, a unique situation exists where demand for rentals continues to outstrip supply, creating a compelling environment for investors. So come see for yourself. Join me April 16th through 19th in Ambergris Key, Belize, as we study the market, learn about the sustainable drivers, and tour lots of beautiful real estate. And like all of our field trips, there are no properties for sale during the weekend. Rather, you'll meet lots of local providers that will help educate you about the market so that you can follow up with them after the trip if the market seems interesting to you. You've heard about Belize and the Real Estate Guys for all these years. Now come see what all the excitement is about. Plus, we'll have lots of time over meals and activities to talk about all things real estate. To get the details, go to the website at realestateguysradio.com and click on Events, where you'll find the Belize Discovery Trips. Once you register, you'll get information about our group hotel rates as well as travel details. So join me in Belize, April 16th through 19th. It's a beautiful country with lots of amazing possibilities, and the only thing missing is you. Go to realestateguysradio.com under Events, and I look forward to seeing you in beautiful Belize.
Hi, this is Simon Black from SovereignMan.com, and you're listening to The Real Estate Guys.
Welcome back to The Real Estate Guys radio program. Thanks for tuning into the show. Be sure and make plans to join us for the 2021 Investor Summit, our 19th year in a row. It's going to be extraordinary. You can get all the details at our website at realestateguysradio.com under the button that says Summit. It's our 2021 predictions panel, and before we get back to the predictions, it's time to play real estate trivia. That's your chance to win a prize by knowing today's real estate trivia question, and it's a good one. It's a cool book called The One Thing That Changed Everything, put together by our friend and Jim Rohn's business partner, Kyle Wilson. That can be yours. If you know today's real estate trivia question, in just a minute, when I give you the question, you're going to fire off the answer to trivia at realestateguysradio.com. Trivia at realestateguysradio.com. Include your name, the answer to the question, and your mailing address so that we can send you that prize. Last week on the program, it was Ask the Guys, and we asked you this. In one of its many renovations from 1949 to 1952, the White House was completely gutted and rebuilt with a major construction update. What was it? Well, I'm sure they replaced some furniture and carpeting, but the major thing was all of the White House's original wooden joists were replaced with concrete and steel beams. Even the White House, at one point, was a fixer-upper. Here's our real estate trivia question for this week. Which U.S. city commanded the highest rent in 2020? Yeah, rents have varied a lot in 2020. Which U.S. city got the highest rents? If you think you know or just want to take a guess, send your best guess to trivia at realestateguysradio.com. Trivia at realestateguysradio.com. Include your name, your guess, and your physical mailing address, because the first person that gets it right gets a copy of this great book, The One Thing That Changed Everything. That's today's real estate trivia question. It is our 2021 predictions panel. Where do our friends and experts see the puck going? And our next guest is no stranger to prognosticating. In fact, every year he does his own predictions webinar. Here to share some of his big takeaways, it's the apartment king, Brad Sumrok. Hey, Brad, Happy New Year.
Hey, Robert, I'm happy to be here in 2021.
How about that? I'm not tired of saying Happy New Year yet, even though it's been a while. But, you know, you went through, like we all did, this big shift in 2020, and we had you on the show to talk about the things you were paying attention and looking at and, you know, kind of helping your students navigate through uncharted waters. Now here we are with a brand new year. There's still lockdowns. There's still COVID. What are the things that you're paying attention to in this year?
Well, you know, just recapping what you mentioned in 2020, I mean, we had almost two quarters of very little transactional activity, and not just within my program and nationwide, but what we saw in the fourth quarter of 2020 that's also moving into 2021 is we were kind of back in business as usual. So, I mean, we look at things like job growth, population growth, and we lost almost 10 million jobs in 2020. And now a lot of these jobs are coming back, especially in some of these more pandemic resilient markets. And so we're seeing tons of apartment activity. We saw a lot of transactions in Q4 of 2020, and we're seeing a lot of activity in 2021.
Now, Brad, anyone who's been to one of your trainings knows that you kind of outline the critical factors you look for in markets. And those are kind of evergreen concepts, the idea of going where it's more landlord-friendly in terms of tenant-landlord law than tenant-friendly, where there are jobs increasing and not decreasing, many of those things. So as we approach a new year and we have seen the results of the layoffs and eviction moratoriums and so forth, it's probably even more important that you're looking at these markets that are, you know, pandemic resistant at least.
Yeah, so like you mentioned, I mean, historically for 18 years, here's what I look for: landlord friendly and business friendly, job growth, population growth, affordability gap. But now we have a whole nother thing that we look for, and that's, you know, how resilient a market has been during the pandemic and continues to be. So like, we have a lot of students and properties, say in Central Florida, but now we know that Orlando is more susceptible to the pandemic because of the jobs that are in the tourist industry. Same with Las Vegas. So those markets are not on my top list for 2021. But markets like Tampa and Jacksonville still are. And so, you know, there's a lot of markets that have performed really, really well during the pandemics, almost so well that it's barely noticeable in terms of collections, how they've performed. And some of them are actually performing just as good or better than before the pandemic.
You bring up a great point, which is not all jobs are created equal. If you had an apartment building and your tenants were all restaurant and gym employees, that would look very different than if you had more diverse jobs. You mentioned hospitality. That's obviously tough in a number of markets. What are the kind of jobs that you look for that you think have staying power?
Well, I can tell you the jobs that are more susceptible, obviously, to the pandemic, and it's pretty obvious, but it's jobs that are in tourism and retail and things like that, the travel industry and stuff like that. So, you know, the two markets that I mentioned with Vegas and Orlando have been hit a lot harder. So the markets that have a more diversified economy that don't have as much, say, tourism jobs or tourism-based economy have performed substantially better. And there are markets that just, like if we look at population growth for the next 5 years, some of these markets have been on my favorites list for many, many years. Markets like Houston, markets like Dallas, markets like Phoenix and Atlanta. These are the places where people are moving. There's more people moving here than moving out. They're the some of the top 10 markets for population growth. And so when you look at these trends, people moving out of states with that are less friendly to business owners, that are less friendly to taxpayers, moving toward places where jobs are being created, companies are moving there for a variety of reasons. And I mean, look, multifamily, there are so many opportunities in multifamily, and they don't exist anymore or to the same extent in retail, in office, in hotels. These asset classes have been hit really, really hard. So a lot of that capital is now moving into multifamily.
You bet it is. One of the reasons we've always been big fans of residential property and apartments in particular is because no matter what, people need a roof over their heads. And the kind of folks that you typically cater to are people that are working people that have jobs and can afford the rent, and they aren't at the poverty level, but they aren't to the point where they're probably ready to buy their own home. So this creates a sweet little spot already. Now you add to it the changes that we've seen. And although certainly the U.S. lost a lot of jobs in 2020, we're seeing many of those jobs that came back in 2020 and some more, and maybe even different jobs that are coming back now.
Yes. I mean, we had probably the biggest job loss in, I don't want to say my lifetime, but I mean, I'm 53 years old, Robert, and I can't remember a time, including the 2008 Great Depression or Great Recession or whatever we want to call it, that we've lost this many jobs. And many of those jobs have already come back. I think the last time I checked, about 50% of all the jobs that were lost have already come back. And we're supposed to add another nearly 4 million jobs back to the U.S. economy in 2021. So that bodes very well for apartment investors. But as you mentioned, all those jobs are not created equally, and they're not all going to be distributed evenly. So you really want to tune into the markets where jobs are being created and people are moving to. But overall, the trends look really, really good.
Well, and I think the perspective is super important here, because for people who are listening that live in an area where there are still severe lockdowns, businesses are closed, restaurants are closed. If I'm that person, I'm hearing this, I'm like, what are you guys talking about? I mean, everything's shut down. I always say live where you want to live, but invest where the numbers make sense. And right now, there are markets that are thriving. There are markets that are open for business. There are markets where restaurants are at 75 or 100% capacity. You may not agree with that, or you may not agree with lockdowns, but that's not the point. The point is, if you're careful and if you study, like I know you do, Brad, you can find the markets that are more resilient and the markets that have better promise in the coming year.
Yeah, it's interesting, just on that business note, which and personal, which kind of, you know, for me, it's all morphed together, but I'd go between Dallas and Florida. And, you know, we're going to the DFW airport, the Tampa airport, the airplanes are full, the airports are 50, 60, 70% full. And then I see pictures of people that are in California showing pictures of the airports. And some of these people in December, like for Christmas, they're saying, hey, this is the first time I've flown since the pandemic. And they're showing a video of a California airport and it's empty, like a ghost town. That's the reality that some people have. And I'm not, and again, I'm not saying that's good or bad. I'm just saying it is what it is. But there are markets that are much more open right now economically, and that's a good indication of where I want to be as an apartment investor.
In fact, every year, Brad, you put together this webinar on your predictions for the year in regards to apartments and the markets and so forth. That is coming up quickly. Tell us about the webinar and what people can expect to learn if they sign up for it.
Yeah, oh my gosh. And it's just in a few short days. And what I do, I've been doing this every year in January. And what I do is I take all the research reports from all the top capital markets teams and brokerage teams and data analytics organizations. And then I go through it, I study it, I read it, and then I put together the highlights and I come out with what we should be investing in, which markets, the top markets, the trends, the economic trends, the migration patterns, the spreads between rents versus for apartments versus mortgage payments for single family homes. And I look at things like the affordability gap, but I go through in about 60 minutes in detail the top markets that people want to be investing in for 2021. And obviously my focus is apartments, but anybody that's investing in any type of real estate is going to want to tune into this because it's going to be very data centric, but also I find a way to present data in a simple way that isn't too boring and that most people could understand, and hopefully also in an entertaining way as well.
Well, for the last several years, we've certainly encouraged our listeners to check it out. If you're interested, all you have to do is send an email to Brad21, Brad like Brad Sumrok, and 21 like the year, Brad21 at realestateguysradio.com. You get the details on the when, the where, then the how. And before I let you out of here, Brad, I also want to talk about your challenge coming up. This is a really cool idea. It's a new year, and you guys have come up with kind of a fun challenge. Tell us about it.
Yeah, the challenge is going to be the first ever Invest in Apartments challenge. And it's going to be a free event. And every day we're going to hone in on something that is very important for apartment investors to learn. And so we're going to be teaching for 60 to 90 minutes a day, February 1st through 5th. And it's going to be free, first of all. And we're going to have a lot of great guest speakers. And I'm going to have some of my successful students. So we're going to hone in on, like, you know, the millionaire multifamily mindset. And then we're going to hone in on, like, different ways to invest. And the pros and cons of being a syndicator or a passive investor. And we're going to be talking about capital gains and cash flow and taxes. And so it's going to be content rich and guest speaker rich. There's going to be some amazing guest speakers. And it's going to be great. It's going to be fun. And anybody that wants to invest in apartments and learn what it takes to be a successful apartment investor, needs to enroll in this free Invest in Apartments challenge.
So what's great is if you don't have any apartment experience or even any investing experience, if you're new to real estate and just excited about it, this would be a great, great thing for you to get your mind around, because it's 5 days of a lot of great content. Having seen Brad present a ton, the man knows his stuff. You want to tune in for that. We'll also get you all the details if you just send an email to brad21@realestateguysradio.com. You'll get the invitation to your predictions webinar, and you'll also get the information about the challenge. So Brad, as always, great to have you on the program, and Happy New Year.
Thank you, Robert. It was great, and Happy New Year to you and everybody out there listening.
There's Brad Sumrok, the apartment king. More when we come back. You're tuned to the Real Estate Guys radio program. I'm your host, Robert Helms.
Need help with your real estate investment portfolio? Check out the resources page at realestateguysradio.com.
In uncertain times like this, it's great to know there are two things you can always count on. High demand for affordable single-family homes to live in, and Terry Kerr's amazing Memphis team at Mid-South Home Buyers to find, fix, and manage the next addition to your recession-resistant real estate portfolio. The Memphis market is a logistics and distribution dynamo with an economic engine that's essential to moving goods and critical supplies all over the United States. Quality rehab, proven profitable property management, affordable rents, and solid ROI make turnkey property investing through Terry's team a dream when it matters most. To learn more about Memphis and Mid-South home buyers, send an email to midsouth@realestateguysradio.com. That's midsouth@realestateguysradio.com.
Having trouble finding deals where the numbers make sense? Invest in an asset class that delivers cash flow to you in good times and bad, and where most of that cash flow is tax-free. I'm Dave Zook. Many of you have heard me speak at Real Estate Guys events or heard me on their podcast. My team is a top 5 ATM operator in the country, and right now accredited investors can make cash flow returns well into the double digits and get huge tax deductions. For your free report on this lucrative asset class, email atm@realestateguysradio.com.
Hi, this is Garrett Sutton, Rich Dad's advisor. Remember, equity happens, and you're listening to The Real Estate Guys.
Welcome back to The Real Estate Guys radio program, and thanks for tuning into the show. Tell a friend about The Real Estate Guys, and if you've ever wanted to do bigger deals using other people's money or invest passively with other investors, then come on out to The Secrets of Successful Syndication. Happens the last weekend in March, live in Dallas, Texas. Get all the details on our website at realestateguysradio.com under events. Well, we've certainly got some great insight today. Before we get out of here, let's find out what the outlook may be for precious metals. Joining us today, the editor of the Gold Newsletter and the organizer of the New Orleans Investment Conference. Let's say hello to Brian London.
Great to be with you, Robert, as always.
Yes, it's always a pleasure, and it was fun hanging out in New Orleans, even though there were just a few of us this year. A lot of people on the conference virtually. Before we're done, we're going to give them the dates for the 2021 New Orleans Investment Conference. It's the oldest running investment conference in the United States, and Brian, you always put on a heck of a great time, and what a interesting jump to virtual, but I thought it worked amazingly well.
Yeah, it did. You know, I think we were very innovative. We had a lot of ideas on how to do a virtual event. We tried to recapture a lot of the ambiance, the intellectual energy of being there in New Orleans with a lot of really smart people. And a lot of that's impossible to replicate, as you know, but we did pretty well. And no small thanks to you is our one of our MCs. And Russ also contributing and moderating panels and doing your presentations with you. It was really spectacular. We did not have a single complaint from the content. All we had was praise. And I don't know how you can do any better than that. So
love that. Well, always a challenge to get, you know, bright people together. Virtual, I know, made it so you could bring some folks in that sometimes have trouble to get into New Orleans. And really, this show today is about painting a picture of where we're going. We're tapping in to our network of smart people. And I think, obviously, let's talk about the metals. So you pay attention to what happens in the metals market, and there's a lot going on there. The last few weeks have been kind of a roller coaster ride. Tell us what's happening and what you're watching in 2021 when it comes to gold and silver.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, there's an established pattern of the early year being very bullish for gold and silver. and the associated mining stocks. And it actually usually starts about mid-December. This past year, it actually started in late November. November 24th was the bottom, and prices started rising after that. And we got just two great days right out of the gate in the new year. And then, bam, we had a big sell-off in gold. And what happened was is that interest rates, real yields for the 10-year Treasury yield benchmark specifically, just absolutely spiked when all of a sudden they realized, oh, Republicans lost the Georgia elections. The Democrats are in full control. We're going to have this huge tsunami of spending and more quantitative easing, et cetera, coming down the pike. The bond market did not take it that well. It spiked rates to considerably over 1% on the 10-year, and inflation expectations didn't rise along with that. So what happened was the real yields actually rose, and they didn't get more negative. So they got less negative. And the direction of real yields in the short term is the predominant indicator factor driving the gold price and silver prices. So we had a big sell-off. And I think we're going to have more of that volatility throughout this year because we're going to get these inflation shocks coming. And the bond market will be the first to react. And then we'll get the actual inflation. And then real yields will resume their downtrend and the metals will resume their uptrend. But this interplay between yields and inflation expectations, that's going to create the wiggles on the line in the uptrend, I think, for the metals this year. So there'll be volatility, but don't let it shake you out of the market, because with all this money coming down the pike, metals prices are almost assuredly going to rise.
Well, that's the thing we need to not lose sight of, right? Big picture is that there is so much metal, and certainly there are miners and junior miners and folks that you deal with all the time who are increasing the supply. But overall, the supply is fairly constant, and yet what's not constant is the printing of dollars. And if it's true with the new government that we're going to see more printing of money, then really gold only has one way to go long term. I know you pay attention to where it goes every single day, but big picture, you know, real estate investors, they aren't going to get in and out and trade. They're going to think about having some in their portfolio long term. So paint the picture of how someone like a listener of ours who primarily invests in real estate may want to hold on to some metals.
Well, the size of the debt right now, people ask me, what are the factors that are driving gold up? And I said, there's three predominant factors: debt, debt, and debt.
Yeah.
And it's like real estate. And in that manner, the debt demands now that the currency, the underlying currency that the debt is denominated, has to be devalued because the debt is crushing at these levels. It also means that interest rates can't rise to any appreciable extent or rise to any real, on an inflation adjusted basis, being positive at all, because the cost of servicing the federal debt would crush the federal budget. So rates have to be ultra low to negative, and the currency has to significantly depreciate. The only way to protect yourself from that is by owning physical metals and other assets as well, real estate, tangible assets, et cetera. But from a monetary standpoint, the monetary metals, gold and silver, are the predominant and most effective ways of really ensuring your wealth against the steady and inevitable depreciation of the currency. So don't worry about what's going on today or next week. Look 2, 3 years, 5 years down the road and know that the dollar's got to be much cheaper against real things, against that debt. And the way to insure yourself against that is through precious metals.
Well, we wanted to wrap up on today's show with your perspective, because while a lot of our guests have talked about things that are likely to happen this year and things like the, you know, eviction moratoriums in real estate and what we're seeing in terms of interest rates, gold and silver have a long-term play for people. Certainly, there are ways to get involved with the mining stocks and so forth, and you do a great job in Gold Newsletter of addressing that, but you also address just the basic fundamentals of the market, which we appreciate. Hey, before we get you out of here, coming up, it's going to be later this year, the New Orleans Investment Conference 2021. Give us the dates and tell us what you can so people can pencil this in on their calendars.
October 17th through 20th, and we are going full guns, pedal to the metal, a live in-person event. There'll be a full component, there'll be a hybrid, but it's going to be a big, a welcoming party, a coming home event. It's going to be, I believe, the first big investment event that's actually going to be in person. We're knocking on wood that everything will be fairly normal at that point, fairly safe to travel. And we're going for it. And I think it's going to be, from what I've heard from our attendees, our exhibitors, our speakers, everybody's so eager to get back to New Orleans. So it's going to be just a real blockbuster event.
Well, I can't wait. It's always a highlight of our year, and you can count on us being there. There's Brian London. You can find out more about what Brian does with Jefferson Companies, and that does both the New Orleans Investment Conference, which is an annual amazing gathering of folks, not just talking about metals, but talking about all kinds of real assets, as well as the gold newsletter. If you're thinking about getting into the metals, the newsletter is just a really cool way to get your mind around it. I know the first time I came to the conference, Brian, I didn't know much about the metals, but just your exhibitors and your speakers are so easy to talk to, eager to teach people, and you make it simple for people to understand. And yet sometimes I look at things like those core drillings and stuff and go, man, there's so much I don't know. But we appreciate what you're doing for the world, my friend.
Thank you, Robert. And with what you guys are doing, we've so enjoyed our association with your group over these last 6-7 years. It's just been fantastic.
In fact, Brian will be joining us for the 2021 Investor Summit on the Sand, along with Peter Schiff, Ken McElroy, Tommy Hopkins, Brad Sumrok, and many more. You get all the details by sending an email to summit@realestateguysradio.com. That's summit@realestateguysradio.com. It's filling up fast, but there's room for you if you'll hurry. To get on our advance notice list to learn more about the 2021 New Orleans Investment Conference and the Real Estate Guys annual private suite party, just send an email to neworleans@realestateguysradio.com. neworleans@realestateguysradio.com. Hey, big thanks to all of our panelists today who stuck their necks on the line saying what they are looking at and what they are hoping for and what they're thinking might happen in the new year. If 2020 taught us anything, it's that anything can happen. But we'll be here with you every week in 2021, bringing you great guests and cool insights. Until next week, go out and make some equity happen.
This episode of the Real Estate Guys Radio Show is brought to you by Paradigm Life. Powerful cash management strategies using life insurance. Learn more at beyourbank.com. Mid-South Home Buyers. Low-cost, turnkey cash flow properties in Memphis, Tennessee. Corporate Direct. Asset protection strategies for real estate investors from attorney and rich dad advisor Garrett Sutton. Find these and other great companies under the Resources tab at realestateguysradio.com. To learn how you can expose your product or service to the Real Estate Guys audience, call 888-489-7723 extension 4. That's 888-489-7723 extension 4. Or use the feedback page at realestateguysradio.com. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next week right here on the Real Estate Guys Radio Show.